Good evening and welcome to Resource PNG. On tonight's edition, we continue with our fourth feature in a series of documentaries sponsored by the Chamber of Mines and Petroleum to highlight the scope of resource industry activities in the country. Tonight, we look at the PNG LNG project. Also on the show, we feature the Women in Mining and Petroleum Initiative that is assisting women in resource project impacted communities to improve their lives through vocational skills training.
Occasionally, a project comes along that has the potential to have a truly profound impact on a nation's future. The PNG LNG project is one such project.
And it's more than that. It's going to be providing the basis for economic growth for Papua New Guinea.
PNG LNG offers the potential to underpin the growing economy of Papua New Guinea and create significant new opportunities for its people. The PNG LNG project will commercialize natural gas from wells in the Hela and Western provinces, along with gas from the oil fields in Southern Highlands. Natural gas from the Heights, Angore and Juha wells will be transported by pipeline to the conditioning plant at Heights, where liquids and other condensate will be removed from the gas. The gas will then be transported through a 292-kilometer onshore pipeline. In the Omati Delta of Gulf Province, the onshore pipeline connects to a 407-kilometer pipeline which goes under the sea and connects with the LNG plant just outside of Port Moresby. Here, gas will be treated further and then cooled to -160 degrees Celsius, at which point the natural gas liquefies. LNG will be stored in two tanks before it is transported along a 2.4 kilometer marine jetty for loading onto ships for delivery to customers. Esso Highlands Limited, a subsidiary of ExxonMobil Corporation, is responsible for the PNG LNG project's construction and operation. Esso Highlands is developing the project with its co-ventures, Oil Search Limited, National Petroleum Company of PNG, Santos, JX Nippon Oil, Gas Exploration Corporation, MRDC, and Petromin PNG Holdings. Over 9 trillion cubic feet of gas is expected to be produced and sold. The LNG plant will produce 6.9 million tons per annum of liquefied natural gas. The project will provide long-term supplies of liquefied natural gas to 4 major customers in Asia.
This project means the world to Papua New Guinea, and it means the world to the people who are working on it, I think. It's more than just building something. I mean, I think people recognize on this project that they're really building a nation and they can make a significant contribution, which is really quite rare in terms of opportunities for most project people. Often you come in and you do some relatively small project, but in this case here, I mean, it's more than that. It's going to be providing the basis for economic growth for Papua New Guinea for many years to come.
The project is over 90% complete and on track for delivery of first gas in 2014. The offshore pipeline was completed in late 2012 and has been tested. The onshore pipeline is complete from the Gulf of Papua to the Kutubu oil fields. Construction is currently progressing from Kutubu to Heights. In May 2013, the first load of heavy equipment on the large Antonov aircraft landed at the newly constructed Como airfield. With the delivery of these loads, construction of the Heights gas conditioning plant is well advanced. On 26th August, 2013, the project introduced commissioning gas into the onshore and offshore pipeline. The gas came from oil searches fields in Kutubu and was the result of months and months of preparations. On the Heights Ridge, two identical rigs are currently drilling wells to produce the gas. Additional wells will be drilled on Heights Ridge and connected by pipeline to the Heights Gas Conditioning Plant. Meanwhile, down at the LNG plant site near Port Moresby, construction work is moving along at a steady pace, making the site look much like a mini sprawling city. Commissioning gas entered the LNG plant on 8 September. 2 days later, on 10 September, the flare at the LNG plant was lit. Also in September, the plant started up the first of 7 utility generators. The LNG tanks and marine jetty are essentially complete. Overall, the project, with a peak workforce of over 18,500, is making good progress. However, the PNG LNG project is about more than oil and gas production. It's also about developing people and creating and delivering long-term benefits to local communities. In order to provide sustainable benefits, the PNG LNG project's National Content Plan encompasses 3 pillars: workforce development, supplier development, and strategic community investments. Training of Papua New Guineans is a key focus area. To date, a total of 1.9 million hours of training has been conducted. Courses were conducted primarily at the project's training facilities in Port Moresby and Juni, and through regular training programs run by project contractors as well.
These people are really critical to what we're doing. First of all, it's given us a large talent pool to build from, but we've also spent a fair amount of time training. And when they're through on this project, they'll have some skills and be ready to go back and work within the country and do good things for PNG.
I'm a drilling engineer for ExxonMobil. My current role here is a drilling surveillance engineer. The project itself is a bit challenging. A lot of new stuff that I've learned throughout the project with my time with Exxon, a lot of training and a lot of exposure. Coming out here and actually seeing a drill rig and seeing everything being set up and getting ready to drill, it's actually good to see the science and the physics being applied here in the field.
The project has also recruited almost 150 young Papua New Guineans to participate in the project's operation and maintenance training program. Under this program, trainees learn about the oil and gas industry through schooling both in PNG and overseas, as they prepare to eventually operate and maintain the Heights Gas Conditioning Plant and LNG plant.
I have never experienced young men and women anywhere that would match the skills and the talents and the character of this particular group.
The project has already made a significant economic contribution during the construction phase through the creation of around 9,000 construction jobs for Papua New Guineans.
It's exciting for me to be involved, first of all, in an ExxonMobil project. And just coming out as a graduate and given this opportunity is huge for me. And I'm seeing a huge future, a long future ahead of me. I also like to, from this training, and prove myself to be an asset for ExxonMobil.
Well, firstly, when I was accepted into this program, it was for my family, for me as to represent my family and to work, to come under ExxonMobil and to be here in Brisbane. It's a very big thing. And to be part of it also, I see it as it's one great achievement.
I am learning things that I will be most definitely applying in my future careers. And the training I am getting here is actually world class. I've talked to a number of my colleagues who are in other industries, and I've realized that what I'm learning is so much, yeah, more than what they're learning. So I feel very privileged to be on the project and on this job.
As part of the supplier development aspect of the project's National Content Plan, the Enterprise Center was set up in Port Moresby over 3 years ago to grow the capacity of local businesses and landowner companies so that they could then take part in the project through supplying human resources, materials and services such as security and camp maintenance. The center has assisted more than 16,000 entrepreneurs and provides mentoring and advisory sessions. Through the introduction of training courses and evaluation of 270 PNG businesses, the center has helped build local business skills. It has also facilitated access to finance with the companies while ensuring efficient communication with contractors, subcontractors, and the project.
Most of what we do from the Enterprise Center is business basics training. If the participants who have requested training are already associated with a company or with one of our landowner companies, then the training will be a little bit more advanced. In those cases, we have directors training, we have finance and accounts training. Basically, we have a broad range of all corporate services and training, and it just depends on the group that's requested the training and has registered at the time. As I said, if the course doesn't already exist and the numbers, the demand is there, we will actually tailor a course which will be approved by the project prior to the team going up there and actually performing the task.
The center has helped build local business capacity. It has also facilitated efficient communication with PNG LNG contractors, subcontractors and the project, and provided support and guidance on access to finance. The Enterprise Center is a very important part of the investment the project has made in developing the capacity of PNG businesses, including landowner companies, so that they can develop into long-term sustainable businesses that support the PNG LNG project or other businesses.
IBBM has taken the Enterprise Center today beyond the PNG LNG project to serve the nation and to serve the country. I take great pride in representing today IBBM Enterprise Center as one of the successful SMEs of PNG. I say that because IBBM Enterprise Center has not only worked towards helping other SMEs build their capacity, but have been a leader in demonstrating that we are a world-class quality service provider. I can say that today because we have earned ISO 9001 certification in quality management system.
To date, 9.71 billion kina has been spent in PNG, with more than 2.26 billion kina spent with landowner companies alone.
More of this documentary after the break. Continuing our fourth feature in a series of documentaries sponsored by the Chamber of Mines and Petroleum, in this next segment we look at the Women in Mining and Petroleum initiative.
The project has also focused on delivering community programs and has already had an overall positive impact on the economy and the lives of Papua New Guineans, either directly or indirectly.
We're trying to make sure that they're grounded well in simple techniques and simple knowledge and skills. Because once you got that, the next stage is, you can apply fertilizer, you can apply weedicides and chemicals. We have a livestock program which looks at addressing the needs of the livestock or the small animals, chickens and ducks in particular, and we're now trying to address pigs. Everything that the company has done so far, in terms of the water project, the agriculture project, the housing and timber program, all of that put together, and the community put together, there is so much assistance and so much help.
I'm with the livelihood restoration team under the EHL livelihoods program. I'm more or less involved with the food crops production, the common crops that we grow around to supply the needs of the people around here in the Hides area. The intention here is to at least supply, planting materials for the people. We're more or less involved with the food security. We certainly hope that the food requirements would be met. They've sold peanuts and they've made over 400 kina already from the peanuts that we distributed.
My day-to-day job is to make sure communities, community and the company are interacting. They are communicating, making sure what people feel, reported to the company. We have supported this community with this catchment. What we have done is we have built more than 10 to 15 structures, and at the moment we are still building some more structures. When we build this, they appreciated the work we have done in setting up these catchments.
There's a wise adage that says, when you educate a woman, you educate a community. The project has sponsored training programs in areas such as financial literacy, women's health and nutrition, farming and safety.
But after the personal viability training, it changed myself and the ladies. I have given them the training again to them, to the village women. We ladies were not recognized before. We were not in groups. But when the resettlement team came, they put us in a group, saying that, like, when they gave us the drums, so with the drums, we make use of it. Before, we had no money in hand. With the drum, we ladies contribute ourselves, and then we start baking scones, cakes with cocoa and ripe bananas. We earn 50 kina with the one tray of cake, and scones we earn 200 or 250 a day. Ladies from my group, within 3 months we earn about 6,000-8,000 with the profit. They go on and looking after their own family.
I have my brothers and sisters working out there with this project there. And I used to think that they will be the ones who will be giving me money when I need money or when I need assistance. Now my relatives, my friends, sisters and brothers, uncles, aunties, when they need money, they come to me to borrow money from me. So people are coming to me to borrow money from what I have baked. So now I see that baking is something good. It helps me. I'm somebody now.
The project also has a vibrant food and agriculture program that has trained over 1,000 women. These women are developing the local economy by growing the produce, processing them, and selling them to make a substantial income. Empowering women through economic initiatives creates sustainable community development.
This is the cocoa, a sweet potato. And sometimes earlier, like 2 days ago, we cut this into pieces. We dry it in the sun. And what we are trying to do is we want to bake a cake, a cocoa cake. So half is flour from the store. Half we will use this cocoa flour. So what we do here is this dried cocoa. Okay, we get them. And we will have to put it here. Then we will mill that. And it comes out with dust flour. When we want to bake a scone, we bake cocoa scone, we bake a banana cake, and we can bake a cocoa cake as well. And here we are trying to make a cocoa cake. So we can also make a ripe banana cake. We mash this banana up and we will add it to our mix. If it is without this cocoa here. So this is all to make cakes, different types of cakes.
In the last 2 years, Papua New Guinea has enjoyed low inflation with high economic growth. A driving force behind this growth was the construction phase of the PNG LNG project and the spin-off effects to sectors such as manufacturing, building and construction, transportation, and the services sectors. The Bank of PNG project's real GDP growth will be in the range of 5 to 6% through the end of 2014. This has placed PNG into the category of small emerging market economy. In addition to direct benefits, the PNG LNG project has breathed new life into PNG's oil and gas industry. The prospect of LNG exports has generated increased interest in exploration in PNG, with new players entering the extractive industry, all of which puts PNG on the threshold of a major economic boom. The completion of the PNG LNG project will demonstrate to the world that major projects can be successfully implemented in Papua New Guinea. Whether it is with women's empowerment, books for primary school children, livelihood programs, or helping a vegetable farming business. Focusing on these areas means that the project can leave a lasting legacy that benefits future generations.
Benjamin Petrus.
Resource PNG continues when we return. In this next segment, we see how the World Bank, partnered with the PNG Chamber of Mines and Petroleum and funded by the Japanese government, is working together to assist women in mining and petroleum resource areas.
Papua New Guinea Chamber of Mines and Petroleum, and I've been joined by the women from Hoyabia Village. Is that correct, yeah?
After being received by the women of Hoyabia, the Resource PNG team was also welcomed by the Angore core community.
Thank you very much.
And in partnership with the Action Mobile and Chamber of Mining and Petroleum, they bring these opportunities for Angora women.
In the Hela province, women are working together to improve their lives through a project facilitated by the Papua New Guinea Chamber of Mines and Petroleum's Women in Mining program.
You got all trainers finished, all staff of Hoyabia, Tari Circuit, United Church.
Underpinning this level of cooperation are the social, political, and economic influences of the multi-billion dollar PNG LNG project.
Most women here didn't know how to sit in the market. They didn't even know how to count the monies. They thought once they get married, their job is to bear children, make garden on the husband's land, raise pigs. And they thought that was the duty. Until the project came in and the project had opened their eyes.
It is the emergence of change brought about by the PNG LNG project that has produced a local response to development by the women of the Hela province. The Women in Mining program was founded in 2003 by the World Bank with funding assistance from the Japanese government.
What are the challenges and opportunities that face women and their families as they deal with the special consequences of having extractive resource projects in their communities? So I'd like to talk to you a little bit about what we've learned. First, on behalf of the World Bank, I want to underline again our deep, deep gratitude to the Japanese government for your continued support for Papua New Guinea's Gender and Extractive Industries Program. This second grant from the Japan Social Development Fund is a very unusual thing. It is not common for JSDF to do follow-on projects. Their resources are very highly sought after. It's a very competitive process, and so we're very honored that they trust us enough to carry on this good work for a second phase. We're also very excited to be continuing our work with the Chamber. The Chamber of Mines and Petroleum were our partners from the very beginning. They helped create some of the brainstorming ideas that first led to the first JSDF program. They were our implementing partners for that first JSDF grant and for the work that we undertook more recently as partners with ExxonMobil in the women and the gender and LNG program, which we have been very excited about. And we're really happy that the Chamber has agreed to continue to work with us and the government of Japan.
The Women in Mining program had emerged out of a series of conferences that brought together various stakeholders and women from various regions with extractive industry activity.
I've been to those whole four conferences, in fact, and the fourth one was quite an uplifting and emotional event, actually. There were 350 women from all over the country. I was one of the few males there. But having seen the four conferences, it was staggering to me to see the progress made by a lot of the women as individuals and as groups from all our respective projects and the impact areas of our projects. So from the experience gained in the first project and the extensive network that our chamber team led by Leslie Bennett established with the women's groups at our all over the country associated with our projects, local level governments and our own industry community relations people who are critical in these projects, we believe that we could do a lot more to support community women at our project sites. So we welcome the offer from the World Bank, who've been our great supporters, to look at seeking a second project from the JSDF. We really felt that we had the necessary experience and skills to aim higher this time round, and so we sought a much larger project that would ensure training and support for the project impacted women was more enduring and far reaching.
Program activities have been designed to respond to the desire of women to build greater self-reliance through the provision of training in life skills, basic literacy, bookkeeping, and targeted livelihood support. For example, sewing, baking, and improved agricultural practices. In a broader context, the training was also about bringing peace and harmony into a community well known for its tribal fights between different clans. The success of the program has been driven by the support of various industry players and the dedications of individuals who have committed themselves towards the emancipation of women in remote communities throughout Papua New Guinea.
For example, when women from Mangkitawa near Hidden Valley in Bulolo ask us to call them back in 15 minutes because they have to find a spot where they can pick up a mobile phone signal, we make sure we call them back in 15 minutes. For the majority of these women who lack opportunities enjoyed and taken for granted by most, this project has really touched their lives, offering them hope to improve their circumstances. When a woman runs up to me in the middle of the jungle between Samburigi and Gobi and asks when the next training will be, that is an indication of the depth of this project.
After the break. Thanks for staying with us. In this next segment, we see how the Women in Mining and Petroleum Initiative has impacted the lives of women.
Communities impacted by the PNG LNG project have received special recognition from the Women in Mining project through Esso Highland Limited's PNG LNG Petroleum Areas Capacity Building Project. This project is financed by a grant from Esso Highlands Limited to the World Bank in order to carry out capacity building and training activities for women in the footprint areas where the company is operating. North of the provincial capital, Tari, lie the idyllic settings of Hoyabia United Church Mission Station. The local women's fellowship has used its own initiative to construct a multi-purpose women's training center. Their efforts have received recognition from ExxonMobil and the PNG Chamber of Mines and Petroleum.
Here, you may not need Lopani Mol trainers outside Lokam na training or Mama Blue Milo here. So you mix him, you got all trainers finish, all staff lo Hoyabia Tari Circuit United Church. Me play you see more because all got save lo sum up. So me play you see more. So this line I'm on play I'm empowering. So you me you see more line blue me yet, all got save lo line more narpla. Mary blue me yet. So this line me play a big play hammer master. Thank you.
We were Valentina Kuman, Priscilla, those are the officers on the ground who were really sending emails forward and begging forward, and they really help us with lifting all these materials here, follow up the management office, the financial thing. Well, there's a lot of process in there, so they were the good ladies who have been helping us. And they also engaged with Leslie, the Chamber of Mine and Petroleum, our manager. And they made a trip here one time. They came here one time. And Leslie was very happy to see what we were doing. And then she took note of all our priority areas, what's our plan in future. So we told them that our priority, all the basics we have gone through. Our priority areas, we want to go for advance, everything in advance. Three areas that we were looking forward in advance. So we need advance with the electrical machines. We were looking forward baking in electrical cakes. That's we will supply all the Hela people. Bakings for Hela people and uniforms for all the Hela schools. And we were planning to build an offense, not offense, but all home for our women who will really be struggling. Those were the priority areas we present last time, Leslie and the team.
The empowerment of women in a male-dominated society is critical, particularly in the current context of resource development in Hela province. What is also imperative is an understanding of the local synergies that can be used to complement efforts to improve the status of women.
Our plan, our leaders, our trainers, and our executives, the body of the church, we really wanted to impart our skills. We knew that there's a lot of women who doesn't have a lot of skills like us. So it's under the law of the spiritual laws, and also the women are bound with that law, so to impart what you have to others who hasn't has. So according to that, that kind of law we have in the church, we're trying to build a partnership with women's networking with other women, and we can show Hela women can do. Right, the hiring people are trained. And so we thought that it's a good idea for us to go to Angore, and we will impart what we have to do.
Okay, oh, here we go. I wonder for what? Oh, Brian.
My expectation from this Angora woman, I knew that there's a lot of money going into the community, but to capture or to catch this money, there are ways to catch this money to sustain themselves in the community. So this kind of training can be with them. Even the project will run done, but these skills and knowledge will be still within them. And they will still be continuing where they belong to. It may be in a group, it may be in a church organized, it may be done in an individual. They can still use these skills to utilize it in their own, ways of how they think it suits them to make money. I think that they will do much better. And still, they will come to us.
to seek more for more advices or any advanced skills they need. And we are trying to build. We have already built a networking pathways, but I hope ExxonMobil and Chamber of Mining will still be on the ground to give us help in whatever we are sort of. But we women, we ourselves will build strong network to make these women's like ourselves. So we want to duplicate one hoip in here, one hoip in Angore, and maybe we are trying to plan forward one hoip in Koroba, and one hoip down at Kopiero side, and we have 10 hoipers in Hela. I think we will minimize some of the issues the women and young girls are facing today. And a lot of domestic violence women are facing. And women will be, you know, different angles. They will be holistically feeding in their with their lifestyles, and they will be good. Otherwise, marriage, now my motto, never give up always becomes my motto. So my motto, I will never give up. I'm planning to duplicate what we are doing here to other women's group, and not only in terms of sewing, but in terms of all other areas like cooking, others like your home management skills, other areas like your nutrition, other areas like your gender. This is one of the, as I have told you, men's dominant society, so we have to really teach the women to balance the gender balance. They can be, you know, help each other in doing all this way.
Thank you, Mary Michael Tamia. Lolugatim Lisla Masin Blomipla, Ol Mary Angore. Women na youth langore for 3 days, 2.5 days. M staff safe one time you na mito gama mas le you. Na mas blumi go ogeta lo bishop le you. Na ogeta ol Mary kamati you na ol ministers le you. Emi soy mo sem. Says he can now walk. Boom, one time. Ol man Mary lo rural place. Em mi plan like come up. Good. One time all skills, livelihood skills. Lo improving life, lo mi playet, lo family, lo community. So I can keep him good la hella behind.
Resource PNG continues after the break. You're back with Resource PNG, continuing our documentary on women in mining and petroleum. Founded by the World Bank in partnership with the PNG Chamber of Mines and Petroleum and funded by the Japanese government, we see how SL Highlands has also assisted with this initiative.
Beneath the lush green vegetation that carpets the mountains and plains of Hela province are the fault lines of tribalism that run through the landscape. And nowhere are these traditional tribal divisions more graphically illustrated than by the traditional Hela ditches that demarcate Hela society. It is therefore no mean feat that the Women in Mining program has been able to gain the cooperation of the women from Hoyabia and the women from Angore. Beyond the life skills training, the Women in Mining program is bringing together traditional tribal enemies and building bridges over traditional Hela ditches.
Angore is a vast area of mountainous terrain inhabited by traditional Huli tribes and home to a large natural gas reserves. It is to harness the wealth of this land for national development that the government of Papua New Guinea and U.S. energy giant ExxonMobil are constructing the multi-billion dollar PNG LNG project. The bumpy limestone road from Tari to Angore is well maintained by local contractors engaged by the PNG LNG project.
We are located several kilometers southeast of the Heights gas conditioning plant in the background. This is Angore Block 1715, from where women have gathered from several council wards to attend the Chamber of Mines Women in Mining sewing classes.
The Huli tribes who have inhabited this ancient terrain for millennia are being fast-tracked into the modern economy. 21st century technology is taming and reshaping this wild landscape. Life is changing at a rapid pace, and many in Angore are adapting to the changes brought about by the LG project. One way the women and youth of Angore have responded to these waves of change is through organizing themselves under the auspices of the Angore Women and Youth Development Foundation.
And then because of my job with the foundation here, last year, February, I resigned from my paid job in Okteri, and the project business development section of the PNG LNG gave me a job as a business development advisor for women and youth in the upstream north. So I was doing that job and was based at Kobalu. And then I heard about Valentina from Valentina Kaman from public relations within the ExxonMobil, rang me up and said, "Teresa, do you know that there is a lady called Leslie Bennett down at uni? She's down there to do some initial training needs assessment for the women in the upstream LNG project. And I think you should go and see her and go and meet her and talk to her." So I went down to uni, and then there she was. That's how I saw her. And then she was also excited that I was not only a contractor employee for ExxonMobil, working for ExxonMobil, but she found out that I had a foundation or association in Angore. I was a chairperson. So we discussed on how we could, what I was doing. She was interested in what I was doing. So as part of a tour, I brought her to Angore. And then I facilitated the initial assessment.
The women in Angore really wanted to learn how to sew because they wanted to make their own clothes for themselves and their families. The cost of buying a Mary blouse in Tari is over 90 kina, between 90 to 100 kina. So they wanted to be able to make their own clothes for themselves to wear, for their families to wear. They thought it was really important for them. And this is what the skill that they wanted to learn, and that's the skill that they identified.
The partnership between the Chamber of Mines and Petroleum and the Angore Women and Youth Development Foundation has provided opportunities for women to gain life skills training that will assist them in the new economy. It was therefore an exciting day for the women of Angore as they welcomed the team from the Chambers of Mines and Petroleum program.
I'm so excited for the Chamber of Mines. Leslie Bennett, woman in mining and petroleum. So the next person will come and lay a flower ribbon on Leslie's neck.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
The women then escorted the team to the community center at Homai. There was quite a lot of excitement as the sewing machines were brought in. Each of the trainees were registered and assigned a sewing machine. Their training would take place over the course of 3 weeks. Many of the women had never threaded a sewing needle, nor had they handled a sewing machine. But even by the first day of sewing, they were showing signs of progress, baby steps towards becoming seamstresses. The culmination of their efforts would come about on the presentation day.
Stay tuned for more of Resource PNG. Welcome back. We continue our feature of the Women in Mining and Petroleum Initiative.
representatives of the Chamber of Mines and Petroleum, ExxonMobil, the Hoyabia United Church Circuit, and the local Angora leaders gathered to witness the graduation. Councillor Dixon Aipe stressed the importance of local leaders supporting women's empowerment, but also highlighted the importance of ensuring sustainability of such training opportunities. Teresa Tangado, the president of the Angori Women and Youth Development Foundation, expressed her people's gratitude towards various stakeholders.
Thank you, Lord Leslie Bennett. You've been come, you've like boom, stop now. You've been come, look now. Look him up. Yeah, thank you, Lord. Action mobile, Lord. Kiss him, Leslie, come. Lord, look, Lord. Nick, Lord, Mary, Lord, Angore. Lord, June this year. Now, I've been come now, asking you, play. One of Nick, play, play. You play like one of stretch, one of training needs. Now, you play talk. Me play, Sawe, Lord. Bake him, scone. So now, me play like Sawe, Lord. Sum up. So you plug to put in number one, sum up. So sum up and go number one. So Leslie, no wasting time. I'm gonna find him some way low. Assist him, help him buy him machine now something. Thank you, Exxon Mobil. Lord, help him low. Buy him sewing machine again now. Salim come now, who want to me plow Mary Angore? Lord, this la time. Now, no Salim, machine tassel come. Oh, kiss him, old trainer come. Old trainer come the way. Oh, no, come no Mosby. Oh, yeah, beer. Now, look him. One talk place. All I need you play, talk place, so you play kiss him, hurry up. This law also call him awesome women networking and working in partnership with nearby women groups and organizations in one area. So, time will come learning you me. All to build him strong blood nasawena. Confidence blood. All by working was him go yet. Me platu, all learning you me, so you mix his away blood. So now I'm you Mr. Blood is la happier. One something me plan like you plan working him. Pastor or min bish minister blood United Church I'm talking you player. Kiss him go na. Make use Lord Masinia.
Speaking on behalf of the trainers from Hoyabia, Mary Michael Tamia expressed their personal satisfaction at the outcome of the training.
You play all school beginning, now we play. Look at you play, and triple week, and beginning blown plan, and we play the fighting man, sit down, stand up, or some up, go was. We play to go money kira, up, was him bring bedlo man, we play to walk in bedlo man. Cook a couple of man, I put in a cam. All the slave people make him, not talk you blow, make him all the slave work the morning. Kid up Nakam, you black king, you blow some. Beginning blow, all fopla. Now, you blow put in a hand, you blow yet, now you blow make him walk, go, now be any member catch up. Thank you.
As the women received their certificates, Leslie Bennett's words reminded them of the challenge that lies ahead and the need to ensure they make a difference in their community. The Chamber of Mines and Petroleum will be following up with the women in 6 months.
me by finishing myself 6 months time, 6 months. But me pla come back na look him. You pla walk him one time something one time. This last 7 now you pla kiss him. But me pla come lo walk him evaluation na. Come lo look him. You pla kiss him 7 finish ya. You pla walk him something too. Or some superintendent minister langsung talk ya. Sewing machine by stop inside lo room na. All spider by walk him house long all lo. But you pla use him lo. Walk him some good pla something lo. Improve him sit down blue pla. So 6 months time, but me pla come back in evaluate him this la training. One time this la, me talk big pla thank you lo, you pla hosting me one time, all MTV crew. Me pla hamamas true lo come lo here, all this la tribal fight na this la am. Me pla no look him, me pla no think him this la, one pla friendly community. Me pla talk hamamas lo, you pla welcome him, me pla na. God can bless him, you pla lo, this la walk now, you pla, save you pla kiss him. Na me hope all same, you pla can use him this la save lo. Teach him nara pla, walk him something blue you pla yet. Blow improve him life, blow you plan a community blue plan. Thank you.
So what did the women themselves think of the training? 3 days into the training, we spoke to one of them. Her views best sum up the sentiments of the women.
Before, I used to do 3 things, looking after children, pig and make garden. That was the responsibility for a woman, and that was I was doing. Even though I was an educated woman, but I don't know any skills training or anything about looking after myself, making money, looking after children, making about personal health and everything. But today people came and teach us all many skills. And then I knew that I learned a lot from these 3 days, and then I thought that I will be one of the trainers. And then I will impart my skills and knowledge to other women, and they can be like myself. Previously, we thought about men for money. We thought that men can help us to survive our family, and we fight a lot with our husband. Now it's good that this kind of training will empower us to make our own livings, to look for money, to survive our children. Thank you for all you come on with this program.
That ends Resource PNG. I hope you enjoyed our edition on the Women in Mining Initiative and the PNG LNG project. If you have any comments or queries, do email us in this address, resourcepng@mtv.com.pg. Or to find out more, check MTV Online, that's www.mtv.com.pg, and go to our Resource PNG page. Or you can check our page on Facebook. Thanks for your company. Bye for now.